we're going to talk today about Isaac Watts and his impact on Christian hymnody. Isaac Watts was born in July 17th, in the year 1674. He passed away 25th of November, 1748. And he was an English Christian hymn writer, theologian, and logician. A prolific and popular hymn writer, his work was part of evangelization. He was recognized as the father of English hymnody, credited with some 750 hymns, which is a pretty amazing body of work. Patty and I were talking the other day about some of his hymns, and if you do a little research on his hymns, you will come up with some pretty interesting titles. What was the one you were telling?
God bless the man whose bowels move.
Most of the time at Abney House. their second resident, residence, Lady Mary had inherited a manor at Stoke Newington in 1701 from her late brother, Thomas Gunston.
And at the death of Sir Thomas, her husband, in 1722, the widow, Lady Mary, and her last unmarried daughter, who was Elizabeth, moved back from the place where they had been into the Abbey Hall in Hertfordshire, which is where, of course, Isaac Watts had been living. And they invited Watts to continue living there, this time with them. He lived in Abbey Hall until he died in 1728.
Watts particularly enjoyed the grounds of the Abbey Park, which Lady Mary planted, with two elm walks leading down to an island tyranny in Hackney, in the Hackney Brook. Watts often sought inspiration there for the many books and hymns he wrote.
And I'm going to make a special point here because of the heronry. He was really interested in bird song. And that is the topic of my program that I'm giving on the 27th in the same venue. I'm going to be doing songs that are about birds or that include the tunes that birds sing. And you'll even find that birds of the same type, same species, living in different places. A thrush in England and a thrush in the United States have a different song. So that's just an aside. So come back and we'll learn more. He died in Stokes, Newington in 1748, as I said, and was buried nearby in Bunhill Fields. He left an extensive legacy of hymns, treatises, educational works, and essays. He was quite the scholar, but he had really bad health. And so that's one reason he was really blessed to have found this family that took him in, this well-to-do family that took him in and cared for him and treated him like family. If we look back, pre-Reformation, of course, the Catholic Church was singing in Latin. They were preaching in Latin, and the only chance that the people of the area who were not trained to read or speak Latin, the only chance they had to hear any Bible stories or any information during the service that was in their language, the vernacular of their region, was when the priest had given the benediction, and before the final blessing, he could stand by any stained glass window, any tapestry, any carving in the church, and tell the story of that piece of art. He'd say, in this glass you see David, and you see the sheep, and he is a shepherd, and he tells the story about how he kills the giant. But that was the only chance people had of hearing the Bible stories in their own language. So that was the only chance they had of learning the information and then telling their own children. Because the peasants and even many of the middle-class workers did not speak Latin. Only the really well-educated could read and speak Latin. So we're coming a long way in just this few hundred years. Calvin agreed that it was okay to take the songs and put them into English, and of course with the help of the King James Bible, they were able to do that. But what Watts found as a younger man, when he was still at home with his family, but before he actually went off to college, was that people didn't look very happy when they were singing the songs. Everybody looked very serious, everything was very serious, and there was none of that joy of the Lord in the music. And so he wanted to create not just a translation into English of the song, but one that was filled with the joy. It was true to the text, but was filled with the joy of the Spirit. So it was an important change. He introduced a new way of rendering the songs in verse to the church services. They were originally written in biblical Hebrew, you know, within Judaism, and later they were adopted into Christianity as part of the Old Testament. And then when the Bible itself was translated from Latin into English, the King James Version of the Bible, we are slowly getting to the point that people are going to be able to read the Bible.
Psalms, as sung by Protestant churches, should give them a specifically Christian perspective. This is Watts' idea of setting the Psalms to metrical music. While he granted that David, to whom authorship of many of the Psalms is traditionally ascribed, He was unquestionably a chosen instrument of God. Watts claimed that his religious understanding could not have fully apprehended the truths later revealed through Jesus Christ. The Psalms would therefore be renovated as if David had been a Christian, or as Watts put it in the title of his 1719 Methodist Psalter, they should be imitated in the language of the New Testament. So what Watts did was take the Old Testament Psalms and give them the prophetic language of Christ, Christ's work to fulfill the law, that kind of thing. We're going to sing four very familiar hymns right now with you that are all based in the Psalms. The first is O God, Our Help in Ages Past, which is based in Psalm 90. So if you have a Bible and want to follow along with the original psalm text and listen to Watts's interpretation, please do. Psalm 90, verses 1 and 2, and 4 and 5.
Thank you.
Songs of Isaac Watts.
Tom spoke briefly about a Watts specialist whose name last name is Marini. Marini said that there were two particular trends in the verses of Watts compared to everybody else at the time. He calls one of them emotional subjectivity and the other doctrinal objectivity. He means that Watts's voice broke down the distance between the poet and the singer and invested the verse with personal spirituality. And that was new. That was not something that was happening at the time. As an example of this, he cited in his book about Watts the song, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. The verse is doctrinally objective in that it presents the Christian doctrine with the confidence that befits the affirmation of faith that we say in Sunday service. He also cites For the World and From All That Dwell Below the Skies, the text from one of our hymns. It goes, From all that dwell below the skies, let the Creator's praise arise. Let the Redeemer's name be sung through every land by every tongue. He's beautiful with his rhymes. The only one I complained about to Tom was the one in the last song because I thought come and home did not rhyme. And it drove me crazy. I was trying to figure out how to make it rhyme. But he wrote with this beautiful intensity of spirituality and personal relationships with Christ, but he was able to do it with a rhyme, which we can hardly do without a rhyme. When I survey the